Okay, here we take a look at the second electrolysis. We have looked already at the electrolysis of lead bromide in a molten state using inert graphite electrodes. And this electrolysis is very similar. We're looking at the electrolysis this time of molten lithium chloride, LiCl. Again, because we're producing poisonous chlorine gas, this should be carried out in the fume cupboard. Now, there is a problem with melting lithium chloride. You can see it has a relatively high melting point of just over 600 degrees C. And it would be difficult for us to melt that with a Bunsen burner. However, if we mix it with potassium chloride, we end up with a mixture that melts at a much lower temperature. Now, this seems strange when you consider that potassium chloride has an even higher melting point than lithium chloride. But this comes into a branch of chemistry called phase equilibria, sometimes studied on the A-level syllabus. We'll take a brief look at this, but this is something you do not need to know the details of. This is called a phase diagram. This is the temperature here on the vertical axis, both this side and that side. This is considering taking pure lithium chloride. If you melt lithium chloride and you let it cool, it will solidify at 600 degrees centigrade or thereabouts. If you take molten potassium chloride, pure potassium chloride, and you melt it and then let it cool, you'll notice that it begins to freeze or solidify at 780 degrees C. Now, the strange thing is that if you take a mixture of these two ionic compounds, and this from here to here represents mixture, for example, this is about 50-50. This diagram here, if you come up here to this point and read this off on the y-axis, you get the melting point of that mixture. So what you can see in effect is that when you contaminate, so to speak, lithium chloride with a little bit of potassium chloride, I'd say 10% potassium chloride, you lower the melting point of the lithium chloride. But equally, if you contaminate, so to speak, potassium chloride with a little bit of lithium chloride, let's say 90% potassium chloride, 10% lithium chloride, you again lower the melting point. We say you depress the melting point or freezing point of the potassium chloride. Now, what's the significance of this point? Well, this here is known as a eutectic. This represents the mixture of the two ionic salts that has the lowest melting point. So I'm going to make up a mixture that's roughly 60-40, or more precisely, 55% lithium chloride and 55% potassium chloride, and this will give me a mixture with the low melting point. Now, you might be concerned about the fact that we're also including potassium here, and maybe potassium will interfere at what happens at the cathode, but we'll be able to account for that shortly. So you needn't bother copying this diagram, but you should pause now and copy this diagram. And simply remember that the mixture has a considerably lower melting point than either the lithium chloride or the potassium chloride. Here I've got my two solids. This is what the lithium chloride looks like. It's a white crystalline solid. And this is the potassium chloride, again a white crystalline solid. What I'm going to do is take a mortar and put this mixture in here then. In goes the lithium chloride, and in goes the potassium chloride. I'm going to mix those well together using a pestle. Remember, the point of this is to end up with a mixture that melts at a low temperature. So there I've got the mixture, a blended mixture of these two powders. Taking a small evaporating basin here, and I'll now transfer this mixture, 55% lithium chloride roughly. This should be in terms of moles actually, and I haven't bothered to be as accurate as that. In terms of the mixture, it should be 55% because the total mole should be lithium chloride. That way we get a mixture with the lowest value. So here I've got my mixture in the evaporating basin. This will be set on here like so. And then these are my graphite electrodes. These are so-called inert graphite electrodes. Inert because they don't get involved chemically. They just conduct the electrons in and out of the electrolyte. So we've got the tripod gauze. Connect this, put the evaporating basin with the mixture on. Going to connect up my electrodes now. And I have a power pack behind this board that you're looking at, and I've set it at 9 volts DC. We must use direct current. Can you think why we have to use direct current? Well, we want the electrode on the left to remain the anode, the electrode on the right to remain the cathode. We don't want the cathode anode switching around. So I've also placed a bulb in the circuit here. You may see the bulb, which is just here. And I like to always keep the anode here. This is the anode. I like to keep the anode on the left and the cathode on the right, just for consistency. So I'm going to connect that up there. Keep the wire out of the way if I can. I'd like you to be able to see the bulbs. And then the net, that's the positive lead connected. Now the black lead I'm going to connect to the other side. It's important that these don't short out, like so. And I'm going to switch the current on now, and there's 9 volts going through this. But the bulb isn't lighting here, and the reason for that is there's a gap here between the two electrodes. Now the moment this powder melts in here, the ionic lattice will break apart, the ions will be free to move, and we will have an electrolyte that conducts the electricity over the gap here between the two electrodes. So notice, even when I lower the electrodes into the dish, the evaporating dish, and even when I compact the solid around the electrodes, the bulb still doesn't light, even though I've got 9 volts trying to make its way through the circuit. So now we'll get underway with melting the mixture. I'm going to use, in this case, to speed things up, 2 Bunsens. Go. So we've been running here for about 8.5 minutes. We're starting to heat now. And we're looking for the bulb beginning to light. So at this stage, you can see the bulb is not lit. This is because we simply, at this stage, we have solid ionic substances. The ions are held firmly in a lattice structure. They are not free to move. So as we heat this, we've got the mixture right. It's going to melt at a temperature well below the melting points of either of the two ionic compounds present. Lithium chloride normally melts at 600 degrees C or just above. Potassium chloride at around 780 degrees C. Still no sign of the bulb lighting there yet. Now we'll take a look short. Something's beginning to happen in here now. Signs of it melting. And there's the bulb beginning to light. it's lighting very well now, so we've got a good electrolyte there. So we can take away one of the Bunsens now, just leave the remaining Bunsen. This should be carried out in the fume cupboard. If I get some damp universal indicator paper, you should be able to show up the presence of chlorine. Chlorine is attracted to the left-hand electrode. In fact, we're going to have to turn the second Bunsen back on again. Needs a little bit more heat for the things. Roll this one out there again. These two Bunsens to maintain the temperature sufficiently high. We're melting once again here. I'm going to use some damp universal indicator paper. And the test for chlorine is it should turn the paper initially orange-red, or red color, but because it is a bleach, it will make the paper go colorless. We'll get a bleachy smell, of course, typical of chlorine. At the right-hand electrode, we should see shiny metal form on the electrode, and that will, of course, be lithium. But lithium being reactive with air will tarnish, so you may not see that shiny appearance. Bubbling again, indicating probably a gas being produced. Okay, I think we can see now it's not going to melt. It doesn't like the fact that we melted it, cooled it, tried to melt it again. So I'm going to stop at this point and deal with the theory of this. So we'll turn the Bunsens off now. And we'll just take a look at the table where you should pause the I'll try to get rid of these here. This is the table that explains what happens in this particular experiment. We'll take a brief look at what we've got here. These are the electrodes here. This was the left-hand electrode of which the chlorine was formed. That was the anode. And over here at this electrode, lithium should have formed. Now, you should pause and take down the details here, but let me explain what has happened. We have molten lithium chloride. Therefore, at the anode, we'll have chloride ions, both from the lithium chloride and the potassium chloride that was used to lower the temperature of the electrolyte. Only one ion is therefore attracted to the anode. So chloride ions are discharged. 2 moles of chloride ions, each gaining a mole of electrons. So 2 moles of chloride ions gain in total 2 moles of electron, being reduced to form 2 moles of chlorine atoms that pair up to form a mole of chlorine gas. And we would have expected to see a yellow or dark yellow-green gas, which would have turned moist litmus red and then bleached the paper to turn it white. Over here at the cathode, we had both lithium ions and potassium ions attracted. One of these two ions will be bullied into accepting electrons. Because potassium is more reactive, in this case the lithium ions are buried, they are discharged, and one mole of lithium ion gains a mole of electrons. Sorry, I should have said this, of course, was oxidation over here, removal of electrons. Here, this is the addition of a mole of electrons. The lithium is therefore reduced to lithium atoms, and we should get molten lithium, but of course, in the presence of air, that will oxidize quickly to lithium oxide. So, in summary, oxidation, the removal of electrons here, addition of oxygen, reduction taking place at the cathode. Potassium chloride was used to lower the temperature of the melt, so that's what is called the melt or the electrolyte. But at the same time, the potassium ions are not discharged as the lithium ions.